Hey, so glad that you're here. If you're a guest with us, I know you could be a lot of different places. As Holly said, we're honored you spend part of your Sunday with us. And one of the things we say around here all the time is Hope City is a place where you can belong before you believe. And so no matter where you come from today spiritually, we're just grateful that you're here. And I believe that this is a part of your story. We're in this series called This Is My Story, and I don't think that you're here by accident. I think that God has brought you here and that he has a purpose and a plan for you being here. And so I'm excited to dive into this series together. We're in week 2 of this series, and I'm going to talk about what we talked about last week here in just in a few minutes. But this series is important because your life tells a story about you, right? Your life tells a story. Every single day, you're writing a story with your life. You're writing a story with the decisions that you make. You're writing a story with the people that you interact with. You're telling people about you with every single thing that you do. Your life tells a story, just like my life tells a story. Last weekend, with all the things that happened in my own life personally, but last weekend, my wife and I were in Kansas City doing a marriage event for a church called Journey Church International. And Christ is in there, but he wasn't in the title. My wife was at a church called Christ Journey Church on Friday doing a women's event. Last weekend, we were in Kansas City doing a marriage event for Journey Church International. And I got to be honest with you guys, we get to travel to a number of different churches to do marriage conferences. This was probably the most epic marriage conference we've ever done. The event was awesome. It was well planned out. It was intentional. It was strategic. They rented out, all the couples met at this, they stayed the night at a Marriott downtown Kansas City. And then they rented out this banquet hall where all the couples gathered for all the sessions, and so we didn't have to travel to the venue. We were at the venue, and just the intentionality of the staff, the hospitality was over the top. They treated us really well, and they're so excited to see us, and we got to be with our friends Christian and Danielle Newsom, which was awesome. There was actually a couple in first service that go to that church. They're on their way to Cincinnati, and so they attended first service with us today, and so I made them promise they would not share this story with anybody from their church. It's just going to be between us, okay? We get there, and our flight leaves Indianapolis at 6:55, and so we get to Kansas City at 7:30 Central Time, which is very early. We typically get there in the afternoon, and so we had all this time. We get to the hotel. They give us early check-in, and we walk into the hotel not expecting anything. There's this huge, epically large gift basket, and I love gifts, right? One of my love languages is gifts, and so I'm like, I'm on cloud 9. I'm like, oh my gosh, I've died and gone to heaven. You know, I got a gift basket. And next to the gift basket are 2 wrapped presents. It's like Christmas morning in this hotel room, all right? Middle of February or first week of March. And I'm like, oh, this is amazing. This is awesome. And so I open the first gift. I can't wait to tear into it. And I open the first gift that has my name on it. And it is 2 women's t-shirts. Okay? And so it's a women's Kansas City Royals t-shirt and a women's Kansas City Chiefs t-shirt. That's okay, because it was for Trish. It just happened to be labeled wrong. But then I look at her, hoping that she doesn't open my gift. I want to open my gift too. And so I was allowed to open both gifts, which was awesome, because I love getting gifts. And so I opened my gift, and it's guys' t-shirts as well. And we're just feeling so loved. And so we take a nap, and we meet the pastor and his wife for lunch. We come back after lunch, we have like all this time to kill, and so I actually took another nap. I'm not even going to lie to you. I laid down, I was trying to watch a movie, I fall asleep during the movie, and so we wake up, we take a shower, we get dressed, we go and we do the first 2 sessions of this marriage conference. And like the hospitality level is already at an all-time high. We come back from the first 2 sessions, like around 9 o'clock, 9:15 that night, and somebody had been in our room, in a good way. The lights are turned down. The bed is turned down. There's like chocolate-covered strawberries there, all right? And there's more gifts in the room. There's more gifts to open in the room. Like, this is unreal. This is amazing. We're just like giddy little kids, right? Like, Trish is eating the chocolate-covered. Somebody was trying to set a mood, and it was working, all right? So Trish is eating the chocolate-covered strawberries. I'm opening more gifts. Like, we're both in, like, you know, just heaven, you know, just. And then I look down at my feet. And I am mortified in this moment because I look down and there's a pair of underwear on the floor. And I look at Trish and I look down, I look at her. She's like, you left your underwear on the floor? And I'm like, oh my gosh, yes, I did. Not clean underwear, I'm telling you, all right? I just kind of went to the shower and like, you know, just anyway. And I'm like, oh my gosh, People from the church were in our room and my underwear's right there by the strawberries. Like, this is not right. And she's like, they came in, they're gonna think we're slobs. Everything that we just said, we have no credibility now that your underwear's on the floor. She's like, how irresponsible can you be? So now the mood is gone. Strawberry's not working, right? It doesn't matter if they're covered in chocolate. It's over, right? Like, the lights go way up and we're now in a discussion about responsibility and how I should pick up my underwear and put them in the suitcase. But I didn't want to get my dirty clothes, my clean clothes dirty with the dirty underwear. So I wanted to put all the dirty clothes in there at the same time. Anyway, so I said, you know what? Maybe it was not somebody from the church. Maybe it was the hotel staff. Maybe we don't have to look so bad in front of the church. You know, here we are, guest speakers that leave underwear everywhere. And I'm like, how could you not see that, is what I said to her. But anyway, so the next morning I go down to say thank you, and I happen to subtly say, a lot of trouble trying to get in our room, huh? Like, how'd you guys pull that off? Thankfully, it was the hotel staff. So just the hotel staff thinks that we're slobs, not the church, all right? So, but everything we do, right? Everything you do tells a story about you. And my wife was completely embarrassed of the story that I told the Marriott staff at the Kansas City Hotel, right? She was just mortified that I would actually do this. But everything you do, every choice you make, every relationship that you have tells a story about you. But here's why this series is so important. More important than the story that you tell about you, God is writing a story with your life. God is the author of your story, and you have a story that God is writing with your life. And here's why it's so important, because you only have one chance to live your story. You don't get a rewrite. There's not a do-over at the end of your life. You get one chance to write the story that God has for your life. You get one chance to partner with the God of this universe to write an eternal story that has an eternal purpose, that carries eternal weight, that allows your life, your one and only life, to make a difference in this world. You have one shot. You get one time. And you were created for greatness. You were created with gifts and talents and abilities and passions that are unique to you, and they make up your story. If you were not here last week, I can't encourage you enough to go back and to watch the first week of this series. Darren Erlewine, he's the founder of Pub Theology, Radio Theology. He's a teaching pastor at Mercy Road. He was here last week, and he kicked off this series, and the message is not only phenomenal, and it rocked me. It was just so good, and I soaked up so much of what he said, and some of it wasn't rocket science. It was just something that I kind of knew intuitively. I just never thought about it that way. You ever have somebody that speaks, and you're like, oh my gosh, that just unlocked something to me. That was Darren's sermon last week, and it was absolutely incredible. So I want you to go watch it, not only because it's good, but because each of the messages in the series build on each other. And so we're going to pick up with part two, but you're going to need to go back to kind of watch part one to be able to kind of follow along during the series. And so today, last week he talked about discovering God's purpose and how each of us have the spiritual DNA and that God has set us apart to do incredible things. And as you realize your purpose, and as you realize that you have a mission that God has set aside for you, what I want to talk to you about is how God provides for us in the midst of pursuing that purpose. That God doesn't just give us a purpose and give us passions and give us gifts and abilities and says, okay, good luck to you. No, that God, as we embrace God's purpose for our life and as we discover what we're meant to do on this earth, we're not just meant to take up, 40 hours a week at a job. We're not just meant to go through life, go through the motions. We're not just meant to have this mediocre story. As we discover the eternal purpose that God has for us, God provides for us along the way to accomplish the purpose that he sets out in mind for us. God will give you what you need to live out the purpose that he has for you. I grew up poor, we lived in a trailer park growing up. We moved to a house, I think, when I was, 10 or 11 years old. And so I just grew up not having a lot of money. My dad worked. He just didn't make a lot of money. My mom was a stay-at-home mom for much of my growing up years. And so we were on food stamps a lot. We were on government assistance. I remember standing in line for government cheese. Like, that's kind of a joke, but that was the reality of my life. We got bread and government cheese that was given to us. I think we got some peanut butter too. Like, there was certain staples that we were given because we were on government assistance. And I made a decision when I was like 12 years old to get a job. I got a paper out. And because I made a decision that I never wanted to be as poor as I was growing up. Like, I was going to provide for me. I was going to have money. If my parents didn't have money, I was not going to live the life that my parents lived. And so from that moment on, from the time I was 12 until today, I've always had a job. I've always had income. I've always had this means of providing for myself. What took place, though, in the process of that, in reacting to not having enough, I developed a scarcity mindset. I developed this fear that I would never have enough. And so as I've gotten older, I've had to fight against that fear. Because as I've gotten older, I've made more money. As I've gotten older, you know, you go through seasons of your life. I have two college students now, but that's over. But I mean, I make enough to give them more. You know what I mean? So I go through these seasons where I'm fearful of not having enough. I know that God cognitively is going to provide. I'm just scared that he won't. And what that scarcity mindset has cost me is it's cost me intimacy in my marriage relationship at times, because I become so controlling and such a micromanager of our finances that I drive my wife crazy. And it's also cost me, for years, it cost me a sense of joy when it came to generosity. I didn't give because I wanted to give. I gave because God told me to, and I needed to because I was a pastor. And if I don't give, then, you know, I'm not really being obedient. And so it wasn't really this joy. It was this fear that I was going to disappoint God or not be obedient that caused me just to give, not out of a generous heart, but out of an obligation. And then I was just nervous that if I did give, then God wasn't going to provide for me along the way. So is this a cycle in my life that continued to wreak havoc on me? And what I began to realize as I kind of dissected this is, I think we all ask this question, is God really going to provide what I need? What if God doesn't provide? But what we really are asking is this, what if God doesn't give me what I want? Right? When we think about your life, and you ask this question, well, what if I step out in faith and God doesn't show up? What if I, you know, take a new job and don't travel as much? What if God doesn't provide? What we're really asking is, what if God doesn't give me what I think he should? What if God isn't created in my image? I'm actually created in his. And what if he doesn't show up in the way that I think he ought to show up? And so we couch our fears under this dilemma that we don't think that God's going to provide. But what we're really saying is, God, I don't think you're going to give me all that I want. And God giving you all that you want isn't provision. That's not provision. I put this in your notes. Provision is God meeting my needs, not fulfilling my wants. And there's a promise over and over and over again all throughout the scriptures that God will meet your needs. It goes from the Old Testament all the way through the New Testament. From the person of Jesus into the writings of the Apostle Paul, all throughout the Old Testament, there's this promise that God will meet our needs. It doesn't mean that he'll fulfill our desires. It doesn't mean that he will meet all of our wants, but he does promise his provision, which is him meeting our needs. And the truth of your story and the truth of my story is this, that God has given you an eternal purpose. He's given you an opportunity in this life to make a difference with your one and only life. And as you pursue that purpose, he will provide. He'll do it. He'll provide a means for you to live out that purpose. So what I want to do today is I want to look at this passage of scripture in 1 Kings chapter 3. It's probably an obscure passage of scripture. Maybe you haven't read it before. But it's an illustration of God and his provision through a prophet, Elisha. Now, before we read it, there's two prophets that sound alike in the Old Testament. There's Elijah and there's Elisha. And Elisha was kind of the protege. He was kind of the... He was mentored by the prophet Elijah. And these two guys specifically, more than most of the other prophets in the Old Testament, some of the other prophets, prophet basically just means someone who speaks on God's behalf. They speak on behalf of God. So they have an authority that they speak with. Sometimes they tell the future. Sometimes they prophesy about things that are going to come. Sometimes they just challenge the people of Israel to live a better life. And they bring a sense of God's word and a sense of God's judgment to the people in that time. It's not necessarily what's going to happen in the future. It's what they need to do right then. But Elijah and Elisha were two prophets that not only spoke on behalf of God, they were given the ability to perform miracles. They had this power from God that is not manifested in any other, in a lot of the other prophets. Not any other prophet, but a lot of the other prophets. And Elisha specifically, after Elijah goes into heaven, Elijah takes the mantle of leadership, and he takes the mantle of speaking on behalf of God. And he also is the military strategist for the nation of Israel. He can see the future. He can see military strategy. He can predict what an army is going to do. And so he was a confidant, and he was an advisor to the king of Israel, actually to four different kings of Israel, to protect them from enemies. God used him not only to speak truth into the heart of the king and to speak truth into the lives of the nation of Israel, he used him as a canopy of protection to protect the nation of Israel. He would say things like, hey, they're going to attack you from the west, and so get your soldiers ready. And he would allow the nation of Israel to conquer kingdoms that they and fight battles and win wars that they should not have fought, they should not have won, and they should not have conquered. And so Elisha was very important to the health and the well-being of the nation of Israel. And so we pick up the story, and Elisha is on his deathbed, and the king realizes that he's about to die. It says this in 1 Kings chapter 3. We're going to read verses 14 through 20. It'll be on the screens. Excuse me. It says, when Elisha was in his last illness, another translation says, when Elisha had the illness that would eventually kill him. Okay, so he's been sick. This is the last time he's going to be sick because he's getting ready to die. King Joash of Israel visited him and wept over him. Now, the king visits him and he weeps over him. I don't think because they're such good friends. I think he weeps over him because he realizes how important he is to their military protection. And he realizes that he's about to lose the canopy of protection that has been in place for three previous kings as well. My father, I see the chariots and charioteers of Israel, he cried. Elisha told him, get a bow and some arrows. And the king did as he was told. Now, Elisha's getting ready to have this dialogue with the king, and you're going to see a pattern throughout this passage of scripture that's really important as it pertains to provision. So he says, hey, we're getting ready to fight a war. Go get an arrow, go get some arrows, and go get a bow. And then the following verse says, and the king did what he was told. Okay, now, let's go on. Elisha told him, put your hand on the bow. And Elisha laid his own hands on the king's hands. Then he commanded, open the eastern window. And he opened it. Then he said, shoot. So he shot the arrow. So there's this pattern that Elisha commands him to do something and the king did it. Kings were not bossed around. Kings were not set up to take orders from anybody. Here, Elisha, he goes to weep over him right before he dies. The guy could have been hallucinating, right? Hey, open the eastern window. What's the king do? He opens it. Hey, get some arrows and get a bow. What's he do? He gets it. Shoot. What's he do? He shoots. There's a direct connection to our willingness to listen to the voice of God and to do what he says and to God's provision for us as we pursue our purpose. There's a direct correlation to our willingness to obey what God says and to see God's provision in our life. And oftentimes what happens is we want to do our own thing, and then we want to God to provide in the way that he's promised to, and then we don't understand when he does not show up. But here, the king says, you know what? There's a direct correlation. As crazy as it sounds to open the eastern window, as crazy as it sounds to get a bow and arrow, we're going to fight an entire army, but you want me to shoot one arrow? He doesn't question him. He doesn't say anything. He just does what he says. And I think that there's an insight there that if you don't feel like God is providing in your life, if you don't feel like God is leading you, if you don't feel like God is protecting you, my first question is, are you listening to his voice? Are you doing what he says? Because there is a direct correlation. What unlocks God's provision in our life is our willingness to hear what he says and then to obey it. Okay, so goes on. He shoots the arrow. Elisha proclaimed, this is the Lord's arrow, an arrow of victory over Aram, for you will completely conquer the Arameans. At Aphek. Verse 18, then he said, now pick up the other arrows and strike them against the ground. So the king picked them up and struck the ground three times. But the man of God was angry with him. You should have struck the ground five or six times, he exclaimed. Then you would have beaten Aram until it was entirely destroyed. Now you'll only be victorious three times. Now I love verse 20. Then Elisha died and was buried. That has nothing to do with the message. I just wanted to throw that in there. We could have stopped at verse 19. I'm just like, okay, that was abrupt, right? I'm like, oh, hey, that's why I know the Bible's true, right? Like, if the Bible wasn't true, this would not even be in there. Then Elisha died and was buried. Okay, we're just moving on, all right? That was, hey, there you go. And he's dead, all right? He's out, all right. But I just love that. So here's what I want to do. I want to give you some principles from this passage that I think allow us to see God's provision as we pursue our purpose. As you unlock God's purpose in your life, as you pursue the story that God has written in your life, he is going to provide as we allow him to. And the first thing is this, God will give you what you need. The first principle we see here is that God will give you what you need. Verse 15, Elisha told him, get a bow and some arrows. And the king did what he was told. Now, that bow didn't just magically appear. He didn't call a bow down from heaven. He didn't say, oh, let me conjure up a little spell here to give you some arrows. The king had a bow, and he already had the arrows. Elisha just commanded him to go retrieve and to use what he had already been provided with. And my belief is, God gives us everything we need in the season that we're in to accomplish the purpose and the plan that he has for our life. We just have to recognize it. We just have to be willing to use it. We just have to be willing to see it. God gives us everything that we need. Our church is growing. It's amazing to see all that God's done in the last 2.5 years. And last Sunday night, we had a gathering with our First Impressions team. We have a little over, I think we have like 116 adults on our First Impressions team, and about 40 to 45 people came to this dinner that we had last Sunday. And, you know, I was hoping that more of our First Impressions team could be there. And so I kind of went in, I'm not going to say disappointed, I went in like, oh man, I wanted more people to be there. And so I had like this, not a chip on my shoulder, but I just had like, it wasn't what I thought it was going to be type of moment. You ever felt that way? So I kind of went in with unmet expectations. And so Kelsey, one of our worship leaders, came in graciously after, she's a choir director for Noblesville High School. She'd been out all weekend leading the choir, but she came in on Sunday night. She led us in worship. And so we had all these volunteers sitting in the center section here where none of you guys are sitting. And so all these people were sitting in the center section and everybody's standing and worshiping. I was sitting in the back and I started thinking about like the last 3 years. 3 years ago, we were just meeting twice a month at another church on Sunday nights. And we'd have 18 to 20 people show up. And there was this wave of insecurity that would, as I would stand at the door, look at the parking lot, looking. Okay, 18 is it? Okay, I guess we can start now, right? And I had this fear like, oh, this isn't going to work. This is never going to happen. And as I stood there last Sunday night, I thought God gave us everything that we needed in that season to be what we needed to be in that season. He brought the people that he needed to bring in that season for us to take the next step in becoming the church that he had in mind. And now we have about 350 adults that call Hope City home. And there's this fear that kind of can wash over me. I'm just like you, like, well, okay, what if we're not enough in this? What if we don't have enough? What if we're not going to be enough? What if we're not growing fast enough? What if we don't have enough children's space? And what if we don't have enough volunteers? And what if we don't? And the truth is that God has given Hope City everything that we need to be the church that he has in mind. Like, you guys represent everything that our church is called to be. The gifts and abilities and talents and resources that we need to be that church, it lies in you. God brings us everything that we need to be the church that he has in mind. And my job as one of your pastors is to help illuminate it and to call it out and to encourage it and to equip you and to challenge you and to gift you and to help you achieve your purpose and help you pursue God's plan for your life. That's what I'm called to do. But God is not going to call us to be something as a church and then not give us the resources. I don't know how you are. I have this innate ability to notice what isn't rather than what is. I'll give you a good example. I'll come home after working, you know, I'll come home and Trisha, the house is spotless. The dishes are done. There's a candle burning that smells good, right? The kids aren't just in the house and they're not just watching TV. They're getting along, right? And they're sitting on the couch and they're enjoying, they're reading together, all right? And there's music playing and the laundry is done and the floor is vacuumed and dinner is actually being made and we're not gonna have to go out to eat. And then I come in and I'm like, where are my underwear? Why do I not have any underwear in my drawer? And my wife says to me, all of this is done? And you notice the one thing that is not done? Anybody else with me? Are you? No? Okay, it's just me. Okay, I'm in group therapy. Okay, that's fine. I have this innate ability to notice the one thing. And I think the same thing is true when it comes to God's provision. I cannot see all that God has given me. And then I can always, what if I'm not a good enough leader? What if I'm not strategic enough? What if I don't have what it takes to lead Hope City the way that it should be led? And I cannot view all that God has given me, and I just focus on what I don't think I have. And maybe you're in a season where you're questioning God's provision in your life. Maybe God hasn't given you a spouse in the season, and maybe God hasn't given you a new job in the season, and maybe God hasn't given you a promotion in the season, and maybe God hasn't given you talents and abilities like your coworker has, and maybe God hasn't given you more money in this season, and maybe God hasn't given you your forever home in this season. But maybe God has given you everything that you need right now. Maybe what you view as a lack of provision is actually his protection, or maybe it's his preparation, but it's not a lack of provision. I put this in your notes. Provision says, if God doesn't give it, then I don't need it. If God doesn't give it, then I don't need it. Think about David. David was this guy that was anointed and appointed to be the king of Israel. Yet he shows up delivering sandwiches to his brothers on the battlefield as a shepherd that his family has basically forgotten. He's the youngest in his family. He's not viewed as talented or gifted. He's viewed as an errand boy that's going to deliver peanut butter and jelly to his brothers who are actually doing the important stuff and fighting a battle for Israel, but they're not fighting. They're being taunted by the giant Goliath. And what if David looked at the five stones and the slingshot that God provided in that moment to defeat Goliath and said, hey, this isn't what I need to lead the nation of Israel. This isn't everything I need to be king. You didn't give me an army. You're not giving me generals, and you're not giving me military power. All you're giving me is five stones. God gave David what he needed in that season to defeat the giant that was before him. And David could have said, well, I need all of this to be king. And God said, hey, look at the provision I've given you for where you are right now. Third principle here is that God is our supply. God is our supply. Verse 16, Elisha told him, put your hand on the bow. And Elisha laid his own hands on the king's hands. That last phrase is very important. Remember, he is not just a prophet. He has the power of God. He is a miracle worker on behalf of God. And so Elisha laying his hands, it's a manifestation, it's a representation of God laying his hands on the king's hands saying, hey, you have the ability to take the bow and you have the ability to aim, but I have the power you need to take the shot. I am your supply. It's this reminder that God is everything that we need. 2005, my wife and I were separated for 2.5 months after our marriage imploded. Most of you guys know that story. If this is your first time here, I can catch you up at a different time. But we were separated. I lost my job as a pastor. And I'm looking for work, but I don't have any work. I've only been a pastor. Not a lot of people want to hire people in the sales industry that have no sales experience. They've only been pastors. And so it was not going as fast as I wanted it to, so I got a job at P.F. Chang's waiting tables, which was awesome. I love P.F. Chang's, right? I brought home fried rice every night. Like, give me the Kung Pao chicken, all right? I love it. And so that was awesome, except that it paid $3 an hour plus tips. And we were just so happy to restore our marriage. We were just so happy to have our relationship moving in the right direction. We were just so happy of all that God was doing as we went to counseling and what the work he was doing in our hearts. We didn't really think about the implications of not having any income or having just a significantly less amount of income. And then like a month into this whole thing, we're like, oh, mortgage is due. I got $26 from tips at lunch today. You know, it's this real moment. And so I'll never forget sitting at the Red Lobster in Castleton. It's just a holy place. And we had an itemized list of everything that we owned. And we prioritized everything that we owned and how badly we needed it. Because we were going to start selling off things to pay the mortgage. First thing to go, Gorilla basketball goal I'd just gotten for Micah for his birthday. I'll never forget allowing them to go to school. We got it in July, this is October. Allowing them to go to school so they didn't have to see this guy come and unbolt their Gorilla basketball goal and take it away, but we needed the money. Next thing to go, dining room table and chairs. We ate at the kitchen anyway. We never really ate in the dining room. I don't know about you guys, but the dining room was just kind of a museum, so we're like, hey, we can get rid of that. Next thing to go, brand new couch and love seat, leather couch and love seat was in our front room, not really in the room that we watched TV in, not really the room that we sat in. So we sold that. Next thing to go, hardest thing to go, Micah's bunk bed. Then we sold Elijah's bed. Then we sold Isaiah's crib. And we got air mattresses. We blew them up. Kids thought they were camping. And they were so excited. We're going to camp out in our room. And I remember Micah saying, Dad, why did you sell our beds? You know what I said? Trish and I told him, I said, hey, we're moving to a new house, and we're going to get new furniture, and this will save us from having to move it. I never felt in that moment that God was holding out provision for me. I felt like he was providing for me. He had given us everything that we needed. We just had to sell it. And I got a job and we replaced their stuff. But it was this defining moment for me where I realized that most of the time in my life, Jesus isn't everything that I need until he is all that I have. And so often we look at the things that we want and we think that God owes us that provision. And God's saying, hey, I am your supply. Your boss isn't your supply. Your job isn't your supply. Your tax bracket isn't your supply. Your possessions, not your supply. Your ability to close deals, not your supply. Your friendships, not your supply. Your spouse, not your supply. I am your supply. I am everything you need. And I will place my hands on you and I will give you everything you need. And that might not be everything that you want, but it'll be everything that you need. Fourth, God's provision, or third, God's provision doesn't mean earthly comfort. God's provision in our story doesn't mean that our story is always going to go up and to the right. Look at verse 17. Then he commanded, open that eastern window, and he opened it. Then he said, shoot. So he shot the arrow. Then Elisha proclaimed, this is the Lord's arrow, an arrow of victory over Aram, for you will completely conquer the Arameans at Aphek. See, this is a promise. This arrow is a representation. There's a whole army out there, okay? One arrow is not going to defeat them. What Elisha was saying is, hey, this arrow represents the victory that you're going to have. You know the problem? They still had to fight the battle. The arrow didn't like explode and just like, you know, like the force was with them and boom, everything was gone. Like it wasn't like the Death Star arrow, right? It was just, you know, it was a representation of the victory, but they still had to fight the battle. They still had to engage in the battle. They still had to take on the enemy. They knew that God had promised victory, but they still had to fight. And you live in a world where God says, hey, I am with you and I am for you and I have a purpose and I have a plan for you and I am going to provide. But it doesn't mean that everything's always going to be okay. You're going to have to fight at times. You're going to have to engage. You're going to have to take the shot. You're going to have to endure hardship. And just because you're enduring hardship doesn't mean I'm lacking provision. It might just mean I'm preparing you for something. God gives us the victory, but we have to fight. And you want victory in your marriage? Maybe you have to fight for the heart of your spouse. You want victory in your friendships? Maybe you have to fight to forgive. You want victory in your dating life? Maybe you have to fight to honor God in your dating life. You want victory in your finance? Maybe you have to fight to be generous. You want victory in a relationship with a family member? Maybe you have to humble yourself and fight to ask for forgiveness, to offer an apology. The problem with provision is it's oftentimes disguised as a problem. In October 2017, we had a problem as a church. We had about 150 people meeting at a banquet hall, setting up and tearing down every single weekend. That wasn't the problem. The problem was we would show up at the banquet hall and they would go, oh, by the way, you don't have your kids' space this Sunday. You're going to be in the chapel for the kids. Well, for a brand new church, that's not exactly optimal. You have a bunch of new people come in and they're just like, this place is a joke. Like, they don't even have a kids' space. We had to walk outside, put our kids in a different building. We're not even connected to the actual worship space. Not only that, then they start bouncing us to the middle school. Middle school. I'm pointing over here, but it's actually over there. And so we go for 3 or 4 weeks at the banquet hall. Then we go to middle school for three or four weeks. We build up all this momentum, and then we would move. I get emails. Is the church still exist? I showed up for services. You guys weren't there. Oh, yeah, we were at the middle school. Sorry, it was on the website. That was our only response. And so we had this problem. And what I viewed it as is a lack of fruit. God is not providing for us. But we never would have been in this building. We never would have this building had we not had the problem of the inconsistency of the Ritz-Charles. The uncomfortability of that situation caused us to take drastic measures and move into this building. And you know what happened when we moved this building? This is a problem. You know why? Because we were paying $6,000 a month there. Now a one-year-old church moves into a $14,000 per month building. That's an issue. But you know what God has done over the last, I would say, 4 or 5 months? God has grown some of you in generosity. Some of you have bought into the mission and the vision, and you're giving in doses of generosity that you've never given before. And you know what? God is accomplishing his purpose through your generosity. Sometimes we view problems in our life as a lack of provision, and God says, hey, it's only through discomfort that you will actually experience my provision in your life. Lastly, God's provision is based on his character, not your goodness. Look at Philippians 4:19. And my God will meet all of your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. God's provision in your story, it's not based on your goodness, it's not based on your abilities, it's not based on your performance, it's not based on anything that you can accomplish for him. God's provision in your life is solely based on who he is. He is a God who provides. The Hebrew term for that is he is Jehovah Jireh. Like the Hebrews had a term. They had a name for him. He is the God who provides. It's a part of his identity. It's a part of his character. It's who he is. He provides. It's not based on you. It's based on his character. It's based on who he is. The problem with provision is, provision as it pertains to us usually is only seen in hindsight. It's usually only seen in retrospect. It's as we look back on our situation where we say, oh, wow, I didn't have no idea that God was providing me that new job. All I saw was I got fired from my old job. I didn't know God was preparing for me a job that I actually love. Oh my gosh, I had no idea that God was preparing me for the relationship that would eventually become my spouse. I just knew my boyfriend dumped me, right? And if you hadn't been dumped, then you never would have met your spouse. And so there's this retrospect perspective that we have of provision, but that's not how God sees provision. God has already planned provision for you. He says his provision is based not on your performance, but his provision is he will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. Like it's now through all of eternity. How do I know that God is going to provide for me as I pursue my purpose? Because he always has. And God will meet your needs, not because of what you do, but because of who he is. But there is one caveat I want to leave you with. Now, I put this in your notes. I think it's really important. What you have is God's provision for your story. The things that you have in your life right now, it's what God has given you right now. Doesn't mean it's what you're always going to have. It just means that's what you have. That's God's provision for you in this moment. What you do with it is your faithfulness in the story. Look at how this ends. Verse 18, then he said, now go pick up the other arrows and strike them against the ground. So he's already promised victory. So the king picked them up and he struck the ground 3 times. But the man of God was angry with him. You should have struck the ground 5 or 6 times, he exclaimed. Then you have beaten Aram until it was entirely destroyed. Now you'll only be victorious 3 times. It's this weird ending to the story that apparently the king had enough arrows that if he had struck the ground with as many arrows as he had, God would have continued to bring provision. But the king stopped short. He just took 3 of the arrows and thought, this will be enough. And so he had the opportunity of a lifetime to completely defeat the enemy. He only did half of what he should have done. It was not a lack of arrows or weapons that caused him to miss out on total victory. It was just a lack of will. He just stopped short. And I hope that my story is not a story of stopping short. I hope my story is not a story of ever expecting less of God than he has in mind for me. And I hope the same for you. I want this to be a place of dramatic provision that we not only expect God to do great things, we continue to expect him to do great things. And we didn't just see God be faithful when we were at Mercy Road. We just didn't see God be faithful when we were at the Ritz Charles. We just didn't see God be faithful when we were at 1009 West Main Street. We're going to expect God to be faithful now. We're going to expect him to be faithful into the future. And we're not going to stop banging the ground until he continues to show up, until he continues to fight. And that's the same thing in your story. That don't stop short in a relationship. Don't stop short in your career. Don't stop short in your marriage. Don't stop short. Don't stop expecting God to show up in different places just because he's not showing up the way that you think he should. You have one shot to live this story. You have one shot to allow God to write your story. And your story matters. And he's given you a purpose and he has a plan for your life. And he'll give you everything you need along the way. Our role is to be faithful with it. And then watch him write our story. In amazing ways. Let's pray together.
Hi, my name is Darwin Gomez, a drummer here at Hope City. Love it, part of the band, phenomenal things. And this is Ray, my husband.
I'm retired military, 20 years of service with the Army, and my wife is a veteran herself of 5 years in the Army herself.
Yeah.
We met in El Paso, Texas, our first duty station. At Fort Bliss.
I've served active duty Army for about 5 years. And for during my tour, I served mostly in South America and some places here in the US.
After Darwin left for Honduras, I left for South Korea. And we met back up in Fort Campbell, Kentucky, where my wife got out right before 9/11, and I stayed in to do the rest of my military service. So after Fort Campbell, Kentucky, I actually went to
Afghanistan first time,
and I spent anywhere 6 months out there. Mm-hmm. And during that time frame, actually, we had our first child. So yeah. I do remember my wife one day coming to me saying, hey, What am I going to do after I told her that I was going to deploy for 6 months to Afghanistan?
Yeah, I was really scared. In the first several years of our military career, we spent it apart. And so that in itself was a challenge. But then now we had to add a child into the mix. And so at that point, I had decided that if he was going to be in, I needed to be home and taking care of my family. I was about 5 months pregnant when 9/11 had happened. And I was actually still in the military, but was debating whether or not I still wanted to get out. Because I was pregnant, they couldn't send me overseas. And looking back now, I realize that God was saving me from going overseas and presented me with an opportunity to still be there for my family. It brought comfort for him and for myself, knowing that I could be here home, taking care of our first boy, and even though it was scary, that I didn't have to worry about going overseas myself and having to make that hard choice of leaving my little man behind.
Yeah, so you know, marriage is tough as it is already, but trying to, you know, work a marriage when you're on another country or halfway across the world is very difficult. And so, you know, the only reason why we're even together right now, standing after this, and we're about to celebrate our 20th anniversary, is because of Jesus in our life. You know, we've made that commitment to each other a long time ago that, you know, God had to come first, and He has to be part of our marriage and our relationship in order for us to thrive.
And it felt like at times that it felt almost impossible to want to stay together. And you already have all these things coming against your marriage. And then there's the things within ourselves that pull us apart. But in the midst of it all, I can honestly say that God was truly in it. And it really is a miracle that we're still married.
Throughout my military career, I think I've had twice where I left my wife and my kids, and I thought, you know what, when I come back from this year tour, I don't think I'm gonna have a family again. But during that time frame, God worked both on my heart and on her heart too, to stay faithful and to remain true to each other and to our kids as well. One of the things when I'm deployed was that I always had my wife here, and that gave me a lot of hope. And hope is a very powerful thing, and you find that hope both in Jesus, but also you find it in people. And I'm just very blessed to have such an exceptional woman out here that has always had my back and has always been my hope. And you know, through each other, we've been able to say, hey, you know what, God has to be the figurehead in ours, because in and of itself, ourselves, we would have, this marriage would have crumbled a long time ago.
Big time. We've had our battles too outside of that, outside of the military, you know, with race and prejudice, racism, unfortunately. Look, all those things are still very prevalent, but despite those things, we can't deny what God is doing. For us to meet is a miracle in itself. We would have never met otherwise outside of the military. We're grateful for everything that we've learned, and I'm personally grateful for the life partner that God gave me. I would definitely do it all again, because there was purpose in it, and God was in every step of it. I'm stronger for it. It brought me closer to God, and it brought me closer to my husband.